I'm Jason with the All Things Open team. We have Justin here. Please introduce yourself to the All Things Open community.
Yeah, I'm Justin Garrison. I am just a fan of life right now, really. I was like, I've been doing open source and technology for a little while, and I've just been, especially this year, learning a lot of new stuff, and it's been a lot of fun.
Cool. Well, I want to drill down into some of your passions. What excites you about Kubernetes and Linux infrastructure?
I mean, Linux to me was something that got me as a poor college student to be able to get a $50 PC and type papers in college, and then learn it a little bit more here and there, and ended up getting a job in that space making movies. And I never would have thought that, like, oh, I'm just broke and like I just need some way to type a paper out, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, I can, like, they run this stuff other places.
And yeah,
fascinating to me to see how that is used in professional environments. And later on, like, Kubernetes, I mean, a lot of people say it's, you know, Greek for helmsman, and I was like, no, it's like actually Greek for making friends in your 30s. was really like how I was able to use Kubernetes, and that turned into like making a bunch of friends and joining communities to being able to put my bills on autopay, and being able to professionally use it as a way to, like, I never really thought that like there was something in that space either, but I was like, I was just trying to make some friends, and here I am later, I'm like, oh, actually, like, I can pay for 4 streaming services,
right,
and not actually have, that's amazing. And like that, as a product and as open source and as a community, like, I still value the friendships more, but also like coming from a background where it was like, no, like, you budget everything, and not knowing this was possible for someone that just wanted to learn something and make some friends.
Kubernetes, life-changing. There we go. I want to ask you about modern retro computers. What got you into that, and are you building anything these days?
Yeah, for me, it's kind of like a retroactive FOMO, because I didn't get my first computer until I was in college, and then looking back at all the things I missed, that I love studying the history of how, like, the internet was made. Like, for one of my birthdays, I went down to UCLA, where ARPANET started, and they have a room that was dedicated to, like, refactoring, like, what it was like. They had the first IMP, the IMP computer that was on the ARPANET, and like, I went in that room, like, I did that for my birthday. Like, I was like, this is amazing. I was like, I missed so much stuff, and now I'm like kind of trying to relive some of that, and I feel like it's a great way to give new life to old things by saying, like, hey, we can take this old project or this old case and build something new with it, and I learned things in the process to see how they designed it and what the constraints were, what the technology was like. And right now, literally in my garage, I have a stack of old DD-WRT routers, the blue ones that everyone had for like a decade, and I'm building a home lab computer out of a stack of them so I can use different ones. I'm like, oh, I can put some Raspberry Pis in here, I can put some storage in that one, and it's a really fun way to like explore just the cases and then kind of give people some nostalgia. But again, for me, it was like a lot of FOMO of like, I didn't get to do this stuff a long time ago, and now I get to kind of take it apart and reuse it.
That's cool. I had another guest that they're into home labs, and that was one of the recommendations, was just go build it so you can learn from it. So
I've had a home lab of some sort for over 20 years now, and it's been fantastic. It's a great learning experience. And again, you don't need expensive stuff. You don't need to like go buy, you know, spend thousands of dollars. It's like, I did dumpster diving. I was like, I found computers in the dumpster. I'm like, hey, I could probably use this for something.
There you go. Perfect. I want to talk about curiosity. What makes being curious advantage in your line of work or in anyone's line of work?
They say that the most curious man who ever lived was Leonardo da Vinci. And he just was insatiably curious about life and what he could do. And would just, and he was never one that was sharing it. He never designed it to be like, oh, I'm going to be this great innovator that everyone looks up to. He's like, no, he just, everything we know about him was like personal notebooks. Like, he, I think, published one book in his entire life, and it wasn't even about most of the things people know him for.
Interesting.
And a lot of ideas come out of the edges of things and knowing how one thing relates to another thing and how one idea can be applied in a different area. Like, Charles Darwin he was like a botanist. Like, he didn't do like light. It's like, oh, like, they start studying animals. It's like, oh, I see how like plants and animals do this stuff over time. Like, maybe that's how animals do it too. And kind of these theories of evolution came from an edge of like, I was learning one thing, and then I tried to go in a new field and I tried to learn something new. And that curiosity of just learning new fields lets you find how those things connect in new ways that you can't get that necessarily by going in depth in one area. So you go in depth enough to where you understand the application of it or your use case of it. But being curious about another field is really where you get the new ideas and kind of the new motivation to do things.
Yeah, I love the cross-pollination of ideas as well, of just bringing an idea from one one realm to another and seeing how it applies or if it applies, improves, or dies.
And so most technologies we're building are some like influence from nature anyway, right?
Yeah.
It's like you look at resilient infrastructure and systems and stuff like that, and you're like, well, how does that actually work? Like, what are we actually doing here? And I saw this great talk about someone equating it to your skeleton. I was like, you get a new skin basically once a month. You get a new skeleton every 10 years. How does that apply to like how resilient systems need to be?
Right.
Like, do you need your system to be resilient for every month or every 10 years? And we can build things based on those principles to figure out how fast we need to replace things or how much one thing can fail, and we can just, it's fine. Like, we can just live with a failure, a broken arm or a broken leg for a little while it heals slowly, and we can just kind of nurse it back into a cast and make it work again.
Fascinating. Well, do you have any tips or best practices for the All Things Open community? Any productivity hacks or anything like that?
Hey, this is Todd with All Things Open. Thank you so much for watching. We truly appreciate it. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the notification button. We've got a lot of new content coming we think you're going to be interested in. One final favor, be sure to go to allthingsopen.org to see everything that we do. Back to the video.
I'd say for conferences, if you're coming in person for a conference like this, best productivity hack I can think of is to turn your phone on airplane mode. Just leave it on airplane mode while you're here and not check it as much as possible. I've traveled a couple times to conferences with a dumb phone, like flip phone. Like, I just like, no, I'm leaving that behind. I'm going to print out my tickets. I'm going to prepare for the things I know I need, but I'm going to try to stay off the social networks. I'm going to try to be in person as much as possible because that's why you came. And I love spending time in the hallway track. I love going to talks where I support people, especially ones that I know or I want to learn something new. But then you kind of get lost in the middle and you're like, how did I spend that other 3 hours? And you're like, oh, I was on my phone by accident. And being able to have some discipline and be able to just like, I'm just turn it off or I'm leave it in my bag or somewhere else is a big hack for me.
Yeah. All right. Be present while you're here. Well, last thing I want to touch on here is, do you have any advice to offer attendees gaining all this knowledge? What do they do with it afterwards? Like, how can they make sure they've taken what they've gotten from ATO and keep it top of mind, or make sure they use the knowledge?
The number one important thing that I usually get at conferences is the network, is like meeting people. And so making sure you foster some of those connections. If you meet someone and you really want to like stay in touch, like get a number. Like, hey, like, let's have a phone call again, right? Like, it's okay to do that in between conferences is a big way to reinforce the relationships. But then all the things you learn in the hallways and all the conferences is usually, for me, it's always been go back and teach someone that wasn't here. Go tell someone the thing you learned, or write a blog post. Write something that's a little more, not as ephemeral as like a social media post. Like, here's All Things Open that I learned. Here's the top 10 things. Like, no. Don't do like the list. Like, here's the one thing that I thought was interesting, and think slowly about it. Write yourself a Google Doc or something and then share it with someone and say, hey, I think this is a cool idea. Maybe we implement this somewhere else, or I want to go to the next conference and do this. Those are things that once you leave and you stop and think slowly about things is where you really kind of marinate on the idea a little more and see how it applies to you.
Sounds excellent. All right, Justin, thanks for your time today.
Yeah, thank you.
Appreciate it.